You're watching a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.
Test. Ladies and gentlemen, will you please be seated? Thank you. The joint session of the House of Representatives and the South Dakota Senate will now come to order. Leading us in prayer today is, we're so grateful to have you here. Very much so. Welcome back home, Bishop David Zelmer.
A reading from Amos, the fifth chapter. And the prophet writes, I take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Take away from me the noise of your songs. I will not listen to the melody of your harps, but let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, King of the universe. We give thanks for the gift of the law and for those who work to bring justice and mercy to all the people of South Dakota. We remember on this day those who go in harm's way on our behalf. We pray especially for our National Guard troops that are serving overseas. We pray for those who govern and for those who craft the laws and for those who apply them. We ask for your gifts of wisdom, courage, and will to strive for justice and mercy for our Supreme Court justices, our Circuit Court judges, our governor, our legislators, and all those who hold elected and appointed office. Bless this legislative session, that the words from the prophet Amos might be fulfilled. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Secretary of the Senate will call the roll, please.
Adelstein, Bagalka, Bradford, Brown, Buell, Ewing, Frericks, Heineman, Holeen, Hunhoff, Jensen, Johnston, Jones, Kirkaby, Krebs, Lederman, Lucas, Maher, Monroe, Narvstrup, Olson, Umdahl, Otten, Peters, Rabe, Roden, Soholt, Sutton, Tiedemann, Thiessen, Van Gerben, Valley, Welkie, White.
Clerk will call the roll.
Bartling, Boland, Kamak, Campbell, Carson, Konzik, Craig, Cronin, Dryden, Duvall, Eklund, Erickson, Feichert, Feinstein, Gibson, Greenfield, Dunhager, Jenna Hager, Hayek, Hawks, Holly, Heinemann, Heinert, Hickey, Hoffman, Hunhoff, Johns, Kaiser, Kirschman, Kopp, Latterell, Lust, Magstead, May, Mickelson, Miller, Munsterman, Nelson, Nordstrup, Olson, Otten, Parsley, Peterson, Qualm, Rasmussen, Ring, Romkema, Rounds, Rosum, Russell, Schaefer, Shanefish, Schramp, Sly, Soley, Solem, Stalzer, Steele, Stevens, Tolson, Tyler, Verschio, Werner, Westra, Weck, Wink, Wismer, and Speaker Gosch. Mr. Speaker, a quorum is present.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. Madam Secretary, you have a motion.
Senator Olson moves that a committee of three on the part of the Senate and a committee of five on the part of the House be appointed to escort the Honorable David Gilbertson, Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, to the rostrum.
All those in favor of that motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carried. The President announces such committee comprised of Senators Brown, Olson, Frericks, and from the House of Representatives, Representatives Lust, Wink, Cronin, Hunhoff, and Bartling. Ladies and gentlemen, yesterday you heard from the executive branch. today from our Chief Justice, who in his own right is an expert on our Constitution and will be personifying that today. He's a man of public service both in the northeastern part of the state in private practice, but also shortly after that became a well-respected circuit judge and has risen to our Supreme Court Chief Justice. Ladies and gentlemen, at this time I'll ask our Sergeant-at-Arms to announce the arrival of the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of the state of South Dakota.
Lieutenant Governor and members of the legislature, the Honorable Chief Justice of the state of South Dakota, David Gilbertson.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for that warm welcome. Thank you, Bishop Zelmer, for that invocation also. Governor Dugard, Lieutenant Governor Michaels, members of this legislature, constitutional officers, my fellow justices, judges, UJS employees, and all citizens of the state of South Dakota. Last year, I ended my State of the Judiciary message to you with a discussion of a judicial gavel with a claw hammer on its head instead of a normal cylindrical head. And this is it. It was given to me by a friend who said that judges should use their position to build things. And you can't build much with this, but he thought we could build something with this. His focus was correct. One should consider a judicial gavel, however, as a beginning, not an end of a message. Today, I would like to do that by talking to you about what programs the UJS is going forward with. Programs which will improve our ability to serve the citizens of the state of South Dakota. The gavel symbolizes not an end, but a beginning. It can start new programs, expand and improve existing ones, and complete others. A gavel sitting idle is useless. However, when put to use for the purpose it was designed and intended, it becomes a powerful tool towards permanent progress. For the past few years, I've talked about the importance of courts protecting those who can least defend themselves. Those most in need of protection are children who are abused and neglected. Many are so young that they cannot articulate the suffering that has been forced upon them. Our system provides these unfortunate children with an attorney to protect them, since the hope is that the parents may be rehabilitated and become worthy of the opportunity of child rearing, the legal path of these proceedings is often a long one. In the worst of the worst cases, there is no alternative for the best interests of the child than to terminate parental rights and place the child up for adoption or in a quality foster home. In my opinion, attorneys who represent these kids are doing special work. They merit our appreciation. While some are more recent to the legal profession, others continue to participate because of the importance of the cause. The day Bill Janklow died last year, I was told by the presiding judge of the Second Judicial Circuit that Bill volunteered to take these cases in significant numbers. At the time of his death, he was involved in six of them. For a man who had reached the zenith of the legal profession, and government service to the end, his priority was the smallest South Dakotans who were least able to defend themselves. He did not accept any compensation for his services. Bill, well done, thou good and faithful servant. My legal background is that of a prosecutor and a circuit judge. In both professions, I saw a substantial amount of crime. After several years, it became apparent to me that the criminal justice system was routinely dealing with the same people over and over again. Nearly all of these repeat offenders were tied to crimes committed under the influence of alcohol or in an attempt to steal something to pawn or sell in order to purchase alcohol. Later came drug abuse, where the same dynamic applied. A second revolving door also exists regarding substance abuse. It deals with families. After 37 years in the criminal justice system, I now see a third generation of certain families running afoul of our criminal laws. As a circuit judge, I basically had two choices: either send the felons to the penitentiary or release them back into the public on some kind of probation. Neither seemed to me to be effectively nor permanently dealing with the underlying problem of alcohol and drug abuse. Moreover, the problem remained and did not improve. When I was a circuit judge in the 1980s, there were 32 beds in the South Dakota Women's Prison. I never found it full. Today, South Dakota houses somewhere in the area of 450 female inmates. That is a 15-fold increase in about 20 years. The story for men is basically the same. We have gone from 600 male inmates in 1980 to about 3,600 today. Assuming no special needs, it can cost around $25,000 per year to house one inmate, depending on whether they are in minimum, medium, or maximum security. My personal experience and the South Dakota experience are consistent with what is occurring nationally. In the past 20 years, increased costs of incarceration have outpaced every other expenditure by the states. In large part, that is because nearly 50% of those who are sent to prison for drug crimes will be arrested for another drug offense within a few years of their release. The revolving door and the state's open checkbook continue on and on. After I became Chief Justice, I was approached by Judge Jerome Eckerich of the Fourth Circuit, who proposed the drug court in his circuit. My research showed me that every other state already had this kind of a program. South Dakota stood alone as the only state that did not. We were able to create the Northern Hills Drug Court as an experimental program. Quite frankly, this program was a leap of faith because it had never been attempted in South Dakota before. To my delight, the program showed signs of success from day one. In 18 months, it had its first graduates who were sober, working full-time, and maintaining a family home for their children instead of sitting in the penitentiary waiting to get out so they could get high again. These successful graduates, to a person, have told me it would have been easier to just go to the pen and do their time rather than submitting to the rigors of a drug court program. They proved with proper guidance they can rid themselves permanently of the curse of addiction. In the next few years, we were able to expand this concept to include drug courts and alcohol courts in Pierre and Sioux Falls. We enlarged the Northern Hills Drug Court to include the Southern Black Hills and Rapid City. Tip O'Neill once said, "All politics is local." So perhaps is the genesis of solutions. The movement came from the locale to fit the local problems. In the process, these local solutions become incubators for a potential statewide response. Based on our existing programs, it appears to me to be three needs for success of this type of a program in a community. One, desire. Two, the ability to provide needed services. And three, funding. These locales are successful because they were able to meet these needs. These courts drug and alcohol are for addicts. Drug pushers, along with violent criminals and sex offenders, are not and will not be placed in drug court or alcohol court programs. For the safety of the public, they will be placed in the penitentiary. Some of the strongest advocates for the drug court program I have encountered are local law enforcement and prosecutors who have spent their entire careers dealing with the revolving door syndrome of crime based on addiction. Last year, Governor Dugard and this legislature recognized the success of these South Dakota programs and invested an additional amount of money to expand them. This came late in the session, and I did not get an opportunity to publicly express my appreciation for your action. Today, I wish to thank you for your foresight and your initiative. On July 1, 2012, we opened an alcohol court in Aberdeen. And on January 2, 2013, we opened a drug court in Yankton. The existing programs have been strengthened and enlarged, and we now have a statewide coordinator to provide assistance to the individual programs. We now have 5 years' experience in the drug and alcohol court programs. During this time period, trends have appeared. The first is that the prison population continues to increase and will continue to do so into the future unless something of significance changes. The second is that these alcohol and drug courts work in South Dakota and represent an option to an increasing prison population. In the past few years, there has been great debate over the allocation of state financial resources for such important issues as K-12 education, higher education, and other fundamental services. However, if we continue to experience an increase in prison populations and its corresponding costs, these debates may become meaningless because there will be no general fund dollars remaining to spend anywhere other than prisons. This is akin to a family budget dealing with $5 a gallon gas. What is left? After 27 years as a judge, I am not trading my judicial gavel for a pack of get-out-of-jail-free cards. I am simply asking this legislature, what sets the public policy, to take a look at these types of substance abuse programs as an alternative in appropriate cases to more penitentiaries. While it might be safer for me to sit back in my black robe and continue to oversee the UJS under a business-as-usual logo, there is too much at stake for us and for future generations to take the easy path. I was raised by a minister and a nurse. What would have been my fate had I been instead raised by two meth addicts who could not shake the addiction? The fate of present and future South Dakotans hangs in the balance under the same dynamic. The first time I met with then Governor-elect Dugard, he asked me to tell him about alternative sentencing. I did so. This conversation blossomed into a cooperative effort, which also included legislative leadership. During the past year, with the assistance and input from distinguished South Dakotans, we prepared an extensive proposal for this legislature to consider. We now have sufficient experience with these types of programs to consider the possibility of establishing them in every city in South Dakota that wants them and is large enough to provide support services, such as counseling, to make the local program successful. More successful programs will hopefully mean building fewer prisons, housing fewer prisoners. While there are no guarantees that such a new program will work flawlessly, to continue on as is a guarantee to an increasing prison population and an ever-increasing depletion of the state treasury. I'm sure that a key question in your mind is, what have we done so far to justify consideration of an expansion of this type of program? As of July 1, 2012, 41 persons have been successful and graduated from our substance abuse courts. Five subsequently committed additional felonies. Three more face felony charges. Thus, the program as of October 1, 2012, boasts an 88% success rate. even if the charges against the additional three graduates become felony convictions, the success rate still stands at an impressive 81%. With 41 graduates and 62 current participants, there are 103 empty prison cells in South Dakota which would otherwise be occupied but for our substance abuse courts. There are more than numbers involved. People want to take advantage of these programs. As I said, the Yankton Drug Court program just opened up after the first of the year. The very first day, five people enrolled. A couple months ago, I got a letter from a gentleman in Sioux Falls. He said he was facing a fifth offense DUI and was headed to the penitentiary. He pleaded that he be allowed to enter an alcohol court. Unfortunately, I had to write him back and say, Sioux Falls doesn't have an alcohol court. It only has a drug court. I've also gotten a letter from a mother in Pierre who said her son was destroying himself through drugs and had now been arrested and was probably going to go to the penitentiary. She pleaded that her son be allowed into drug court. I had to write her and say Pierre doesn't have a drug court. It only has an alcohol court. To return to my starting point, when I was a circuit judge, I basically had two choices for sentencing. Either put somebody on probation or send them to the penitentiary. Now, there are other alternatives, including the drug court, alcohol court, and intensive probation programs. These are proven to work better to break the revolving door of crime with fewer tax dollars being spent. They give the sentencing judge tools in addition to the traditional penitentiary sentences and probation. We have come to a fork in the road where we have to decide whether we will continue to be tough on crime in the same manner as we have been in the past with ever-increasing rates of incarceration or be true fiscal conservatives. As other states have found, we cannot be both. I do not claim to have all the answers to this immense problem. Perhaps my thoughts are no more than an initial basis for discussion. As that great liberal philosopher, General George Patton, once observed, if everybody is thinking alike, nobody is thinking. The ultimate decision will fall upon the legislature. You set the public policy for the state's future through its statutes and appropriations for the operation of state government. My purpose is to raise the issue for public discussion. A previous president was fond of quoting the prophet Isaiah in such situations. Come now, let us reason together. At the end of a horrific civil war, which took 600,000 lives, Abraham Lincoln, in his second inaugural address, proclaimed the nation's duty to care for him who shall have borne the battle, his widow, and his orphan. As we continue with the longest wartime period in the nation's history, we have 23 million veterans among us. For many, a return to civilian life has not brought prosperity. 30% of the people in homeless shelters are veterans. 76% of those suffer from alcohol, drug, or mental issues. Today, 18 veterans will take their lives. There's nothing special about today. Yesterday, 18 veterans did the same. Tomorrow, 18 more will join them. We have lost more veterans to suicide than killed in action in both Iraq and Afghanistan. With problems like these, all too many veterans find themselves under arrest and in front of a judge. The crime becomes a symptom of the underlying problem. 31 states have started diversion programs to treat these underlying problems rather than proceed with criminal prosecutions. They are generically called veterans' courts. To ascertain the number of veterans who come through South Dakota's courts, I have asked the UJS magistrate judges and probation officers to monitor the situation. Although the data is not complete, it indicates that there is a problem in South Dakota. While participants in drug and alcohol courts are exclusively felons, preliminary data indicates that the veterans who come into our courts are mostly charged with misdemeanors. Because of their lifestyles, veterans' future arrests are probably for the same type of violation. Once again, there is a revolving door. We are engaged in planning a response along the lines of a Veterans Court program in South Dakota to make a positive difference. Initial discussions with the Veterans Administration and state agencies show promise of a cooperative effort in this area. Last year, I discussed the new Supreme Court rule, which allows still and video cameras in the trial courts of this state on a regulated basis. At that point, the rule was too new to give you any report on how it would work. As I noted, only time and experience will provide the answer. A year later, we now have sufficient data to say that the rule definitely did not result in a de facto return to an outright ban of cameras in the trial courts. As of December 31st, 2012, there were 61 requests made by the press for access. 44 requests had been acted upon. Access was granted in 28 cases and denied in 18 cases. This means that the press received access in about two-thirds of the cases. The Supreme Court has received no complaints about how the rules function or the conduct of the media from circuit judges, court staff, security, or attorneys. Although I am sure the media would like access in every case, the Supreme Court has received no formal request to consider a change of the rules. Our statewide media coordinator says the system works very well and has been pleased with the access being granted in what he refers to as high-profile cases of public interest. We've not identified any structural defects in the rule. It is functioning the way the Supreme Court intended. The determination of access is up to the attorneys and or the judge based upon the facts and the circumstances of each individual case. I believe this continues to provide a fair balance between public access to the judicial proceedings and a right to a fair trial. As Chief Justice, I get annual reports from judicial systems in all states and territories of this nation. The past year, I received one from the Commonwealth of Puerto Rico. It was very professionally done by court officials who I know. As the official language of Puerto Rico is Spanish and not English, it was written in Spanish. Having had 2 years of Spanish in college, I resolved to try to read it to see how I could do. After two pages, I concluded I was unable to comprehend what I was reading. This would not surprise my college Spanish teacher either. If I, with a law degree, 37 years in the legal profession, and college Spanish could not comprehend this judicial document, think how a person with little or no skills in English would do understanding the procedures and consequences of our legal system in South Dakota. For these individuals, interpreters are not a handy convenience. They are a necessity. Last year, this legislature provided funding to upgrade interpreter services. We recognize that each judicial circuit has unique circumstances to deal with. We ask for a plan from each circuit to deal with these challenges. In the rural areas of the state, where access to interpreters is limited, we are exploring ways to expand the access to interpreters through the use of ITV, which is a two-way television system. This has been used for foreign languages as well as for people who are deaf. We are also assisting those who act as interpreters. The UJS is working to create a statewide directory of those willing to offer interpreter services or resources. We have created a glossary of commonly encountered legal terms for purposes of translation and training interpreters. As a guideline, we are working on drafting an interpreter code of conduct. In the near future, we hope to publish a handbook for interpreters that provides guidance to judges, attorneys, interpreters, and the public. The UJS is creating signage to be posted in courthouses indicating in various languages that language access services are available. Also expanding is the number of commonly used court documents translated into Spanish. Why the emphasis in this area? Current data indicates that 127 languages and dialects have been used in South Dakota courts. On a typical day in Minnehaha or Lincoln County, an interpreter is needed on the average of four times. At home, 6.8% of our population speaks a language other than English. That is roughly 56,000 people, and is larger than the third largest city in South Dakota. For the past several years, I have talked to you about my concern about the decline of the number of attorneys in rural areas of the state. While it might appear to some that talking was about all that got accomplished, the time was well spent. It educated the citizens of South Dakota that there is a problem and the significant extent of it. I strongly encourage the formation of a partnership by the state bar and concerned citizens who think the time to talk should yield to a time for action. A task force has been established to move forward. The task force brings together all these groups who have a direct and immediate stake in addressing the problem. The task force has moved forward with a three-point plan of how to proceed. The plan includes, one, providing resources to those law school graduates who wish to set up a law practice in a rural area. Two, developing incentives, financial and otherwise, to encourage locations in rural areas. This requires a local community to buy into the process. There is no way to drop a newly minted lawyer into each rural community's lap. Three, bring towns, counties, rural attorneys approaching retirement age, law school graduates, and the law school together with a website. Right now, the process has the element of a junior high dance, with the participants standing on the sidelines, leaning against the wall, and looking at each other. To provide a central point for access for attorneys, counties, towns, law students, and other interested parties, the State Bar has created a website, which may be found at sdrurallawyer.com. Some say this is indicative of a problem of an overall decline in all facets of rural areas of this state. To a point, they might be correct. I'm not advocating an attempt to return to the glory days of attorney population of the 1950s and the 1960s. We cannot resurrect the past. Rather, we need to realistically look at meeting current and future needs. There is no maintaining the status quo. With action, the situation will improve. With inaction, the situation will continue to deteriorate. Why should everybody care about this, whether you live in a rural area or not? Several years ago, I had a discussion with a distinguished attorney from one of our larger cities. He told me, "For years, we've been siphoning off as much business as we could grab from the smaller towns around us. We convinced their people to come to our city and spend their time and money here. The result? Now, there is nobody left in the rural areas because we sucked them dry. With nobody left out there, now it is our turn to pay the price." The chain is only as strong as its weakest link. We have 66 counties and thus 66 links. Unfortunately, all too many of the links are on the verge of breaking. Hopefully, our current legal system, which has served us so well, will not become a dinosaur lumbering off into oblivion. They say a picture is worth 1,000 words. I don't know how many words a sign is, but I think that sign really proves the point. In previous years, I told you what the unified judicial system hoped to accomplish in technology. This year, it's my pleasure to tell you what we have accomplished. We continue to upgrade our entire software system. As of October 1, 2012, three of the seven judicial circuits have converted to the new system. This includes the Second Circuit, headquartered in Sioux Falls, which contains over half the judicial records of the state. So far, problems have been minimal and have been corrected. Overall, we are on budget and on schedule. We hope to have the remaining four judicial circuits converted by next summer and the entire project completed and functioning in about 2 years. The capstone of this project will include electronic filing and viewing of judicial records, rather than the current laborious pouring through boxes of paper records. Last year, this legislature authorized a modest increase in our search fee that guaranteed the fiscal solvency of our contractual commitment to this project. We are confident that this self-sufficiency will continue into the future. On this state occasion, I'm going to talk to you briefly about the South Dakota Constitution. You may assume there's a problem with it, since virtually everything I talk about up here probably involves a problem. The good news is, there is no problem. This Constitution remains substantially the same document it has been for decades. However, as Winston Churchill noted, the farther backward you can look, the farther forward you are likely to see. Very few people concern themselves with our state constitution. While public battles rage over the federal constitution's scope of our national government's authority over such issues as health care and immigration, our state constitution probably has a more significant effect on our daily lives. Our state constitution gives us rights not addressed in the federal constitution. Our state constitution gives us a right to be compensated for either the taking of our private property or damage to it. The federal constitution only refers to an outright taking. In South Dakota, our land can only be taken for a public use by a governmental or quasi-governmental entity. At the federal level, private property can be condemned and resold to private third parties for a more lucrative private development. Thus, protected by the South Dakota Constitution, South Dakota farmers do not have to risk their farmland being taken from them for a strip mall. Our state constitution vests the people with the power to elect its state's judiciary. At the federal level, once confirmed, judges serve for life. Our constitution guarantees this state's children a right to have a free, quality education. There is no such guarantee in the federal constitution. The federal constitution authorizes an income tax, but places no limits on its extent. In contrast, our state constitution limits not only how much in tax dollars the state can raise in certain taxes, such as real estate taxes, but also how much it can spend. Our legislature has never gone home without enacting a state budget and one that was balanced. We can spend no more than we raise. South Dakota is only one of five states that guarantees a litigant the right to appeal a judge's or jury's final decision to our state Supreme Court. In the other 45 states and the United States Supreme Court, you have to get the court's permission to hear your case. The United States Supreme Court gets about 8,000 requests a year to review cases, and it only grants about 80. Your odds aren't very good. In South Dakota, our Supreme Court will receive 350 to 400 filings per year and review all of them. These appeals include everything from dogs running at large to the death penalty. There are many other examples of rights we receive under our state constitution. The ones I have enumerated are only a few examples of the rights and benefits the South Dakota Constitution grants us. It gives meaning to our state motto, "Under God, the people rule." Today, I've talked about abused children, persons addicted to drugs and alcohol, the need for interpreters, and veterans who have fallen on hard times. As my hunter philosopher friend Clarence observed, as a society, are we going to pick these people up or pick them off? While this state as a governmental entity has existed for 125 years, on this grand stage, we as individuals are merely passing through. The book of Ecclesiastes declares, to every time there is a season. Our time here is short. As with the first South Dakotans in 1889, we must join every succeeding generation of citizens who've had to face the daunting question. Do we want to pass on to our children our accomplishments or our problems and our failures? Thank you.
State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.